Look, I know that title's a bit vague, so I'll explain a little better precisely what this video is. It's an analysis of the character of Janet Van Dyne, aka Wasp, in the TV show Avengers: Earth's Mightiest Heroes. But it's also more than that. Because when one approaches this show's depiction and adaptation of this particular character, it quickly becomes apparent that this character, this representation, is tied to a few other issues. And these are the publication history and backstory of the Wasp before Earth's Mightiest Heroes, and the show's general relationship with Marvel's classic past. So we'll get into those shortly, but for now, let's take our first look at Janet Van Dyne. I think the best place to start is with a quick character profile, to develop a basic image of this version of Janet Van Dyne, which we can have in our mind while discussing the history of the character, and then circle back to and develop later on. So, what drives the Wasp? Well, while she's a rich heiress and maybe fashion designer or whatever she is in this continuity, it's never about money or fame or glory for Janet, compared to someone like Iron Man. I mean, he's definitely altruistic, but his ego plays a far bigger role in his superheroism than is the case for someone like Janet's. Part of it is Janet's deep emotionality, most obvious in her attachment to Hank Pym. Though she stays fully committed to the Avengers even after he leaves, this emotive core comes into play significantly through the rest of the show. Her compassion drives the plot of the Michael Korvac episode, for instance, and a similar thing happens in Yellowjacket. On that note, I think a big driving force for Wasp is a genuine desire to help people.
Maybe you should come work for me, Ms. Van Dyne. The Wasp, Agent of S.H.I.E.L.D.
I like it!
No!
Janet feels a certain obligation to use her powers to help people, not entirely unlike what drives a character like Spider-Man. We see a few times her remark upon the use and misuse of powers. Check this moment out, for example.
Look at you! You're blowing it! You can do so much more with your powers! You can blend giant drinks! Instead, you're just going to the big house!
Again, there is altruism here in spades. But there's a similar altruism present with Hank. Hank also wants to help the world, but whereas Wasp sees her powers as her primary means of effecting positive change, for Hank, this role is filled by his science, which in turn leads to humanitarian progress like the Big House and his Ultron jailers. The Pym particles keep the world safe from these villains, while his AI tries to reintegrate them into society. If you want to hear more about Hank, I've done a whole other video on him in this show, which should be on screen now. But while Jan and Hank both want to help, they conceive of that help in really different ways, which is what's at the root of all the conflict that plays out between them. Alright, so far we've established that Janet's emotions and her altruism are parts of the puzzle, things which drive this version of Janet Van Dyne and make this characterization so compelling. But the elephant in the room when thinking about Earth's Mightiest Heroes' iconic depiction of the Wasp is that one of the reasons it's possibly the most iconic depiction of this character is that there aren't really many contenders. It's at this point that it's worth our while to take a little stroll down memory lane and look at the history of Janet Van Dyne. Janet first appeared and became the Wasp back in the 60s, in Tales to Astonish issue 44. Following this, she and Hank Pym, aka Ant-Man, aka Giant-Man, aka Goliath, and so on, they went on to be recurring characters for the next while, from Tales to Astonish to popping up in other books, and increasingly the Avengers series, the super team which she named and helped found. Over the years and the next few decades, Janet became an increasingly central and valuable part of the Avengers, even being the team's leader at one point. And we'll come back to these years of importance, but since then her role in and beyond the comics has somewhat diminished. While she's still around, popping up now and then, her modern role isn't really comparable to her early presence in the Marvel Universe. Her last really memorable moment, in my opinion, was her seeming death at the end of the Secret Invasion, and after this moment she stayed dead for like 5 years until she was retconned to be alive in the Microverse. And 5 years is a fairly long time when it comes to big name heroes staying dead in the world of comics. And if that Microverse thing sounds familiar, it's because an adaptation of this plot point was central to Ant-Man and the Wasp. But let's talk about it for a second, because the Wasp stuff in the MCU is another part of the way that this character has been left in the past. As I'm sure you're aware, the Wasp is a hero in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and even appeared in the uber-successful global smash hit Avengers Endgame. But as I'm sure you're also aware, this isn't Janet Van Dyne, it's Hope Van Dyne, or hope him, maybe, after she's reconciled with her father. But either way, this isn't the same character. Janet Van Dyne exists solely as a flashback until, that is, she's rescued from the Quantum Realm in Ant-Man and the Wasp. So the one real part of the Wasp that the MCU adapts is a story which comes from the character's sixth decade, from a time well past the peak of her cultural relevancy. And after the first Avengers film had made it clear that this character wouldn't have her traditional central role at the heart of Marvel's premier super team, and indeed after the depiction of her in Earth's Mightiest Heroes. And Hope's a fun character, and I like Evangeline Lilly, but she is a different character. And it's a similar story with Nadia Van Dyne, or Nadia Pym, depending on which point we're talking about. But this is a new character from the comics who takes up the Wasp mantle. People have speculated that her introduction was in response to Hope's appearance in the MCU because they're broadly similar characters, but either way, MCU Hope, MCU Janet, and Nadia, they're all new versions of the Wasp, and they don't really adapt much beyond the basic power set, and they show a reluctance on Marvel's part to do anything with the original character of Janet. Take for instance Nadia's The Unstoppable Wasp, she fairly recently had her own book run, starting in I think 2017. Not so remarkable until you realise that Janet never had a solo book, still doesn't. Yeah, she appears every now and then in someone else's or an Avengers run, but even in the mainline 616 universe, it feels like Janet's being forgotten, left in the past. If you go back and read the early Avengers books or Tales to Astonish, this seems like a halfway reasonable outcome though, because her character comes across as pretty annoying to a modern pair of eyes. She's irrational, she has a short attention span, she flirts relentlessly, even while sort of an item with Hank. I was on the fandom wiki since it's been a few years since I read any of the classic Avengers runs, and at one point their page describes Wasp's early character as a ditzy thrill seeker. And this pretty much hits the nail on the head. And these stories, this characterization, as a result of the shift away from Janet we've noted earlier, they're maybe what are nowadays most associated with this character, the original Wasp. So maybe it's understandable to a point that this character hasn't inspired so many recent adaptations. This is a two-dimensional depiction which feels fairly sexist a lot of the time. But here's the thing, the negatives of this classic Wasp, they're not really unique to her. They are, I think, a larger symptom of how women were often written at the time. So when writers come looking at these old books with an eye to possibly revive or adapt the Wasp, they ignore this Janet and try and make their own. We saw it with Hope, with Nadia, with MCU Janet, and even to an extent with Ultimate Universe Wasp. But crucially, we don't see this with Earth's Mightiest Heroes. We see the opposite. Let's zoom out a little. It has been noted by myself and many others that the Earth's Mightiest Heroes setting is tonally quite similar to the Bronze Age of Marvel Comics, the Avengers' early years, and the time period in which heroes like Ant-Man and the Wasp were being created. I think this is true, most obvious in the show's early episodes which adapt early 60s Avengers stories. Link on screen now to a video about that. But if we look at the founding members of the team, their depictions in Earth's Mightiest Heroes aren't always that close to their Bronze Age counterparts. Iron Man feels very different, and very influenced by Robert Downey Jr.'s performance in the MCU, and his publicity and prominence in this world alone make it feel a world apart from his 60s counterpart. It's a broadly similar case with Thor, with the show's abandonment of the whole Donald Blake shtick being the most obvious example as to why. The difference with Hulk in this Avengers team is that the Hulk is in the Avengers team, that he comes back after he leaves, and actually contributes to the team dynamic. Now, this isn't the case with every Avenger throughout the show. Just take Captain America, for example, who feels ripped from the pages of Avengers issue 4. But I think the most interesting example of when the show actually reaches back and brings Bronze Age characterization forward is the Wasp. Because unlike the MCU, unlike Nadia Van Dyne, this Wasp feels like the classic character brought into the modern world. But not as a tiny background legacy figure like in the mainline comics today, but as a central part of the team and of the story. In many ways, this Janet is the beating heart of the Avengers. This is a point I've made briefly before in a video discussing this show's Kang arc, but it's a point that rings true. Moments like this show the Wasp coming in clutch for the team, and she sticks with them, even when most of the heroes leave the team during the Secret Invasion arc. So this adaptation gets the centrality and importance of classic Wasp, right? And while she was never the team's leader or chair, I wouldn't have been surprised if that was in this version of the character's future. But the really impressive part of how Earth's Mightiest Heroes adapts this classic, forgotten Wasp characterization is that the stuff that didn't age so well, well, that's here too, but reframed. Her manic glee is toned down just a smidge into inspiring optimism, and that ditziness, here it comes across more as endearing naivety. But there's also the outrageous flirtation we saw with the 60s Wasp. Just take a look at this clip from the start of 459.
Ooh, he's cute. Subtle, Jan.
The difference here, though, is that in the show, when this annoyance at Hank's seeming indifference results in her taking passes at other guys, it's broken down moments later into something driven by jealousy and acknowledged as a flaw.
Jan, you have to know that you've got him wrapped around your finger.
Whatever. From day one, it's been strictly business. If you keep playing your little jealousy games with him, he's gonna strictly hate you.
Well, that'd be better than not getting noticed at all.
So, to once again borrow the wiki's phrase, this isn't a ditzy thrill seeker winking at every man to cross her path. It's emotional vulnerability, which becomes a part of the story between Jan and Hank at the heart of this episode.
Jan, I love.
In this way, the Wasp's comic book origins are borrowed and built upon in Earth's Mightiest Heroes, rather than doing what the MCU did, or near outright reboot as Ultimates did. EMH actually adapts this character, but turns the outdated 2D aspects into 3D ones. So we've got a few different things going on with this version of the Wasp then. Her emotional core, the altruism underpinning her superheroics, and the strong and faithful Bronze Age tone. But what ties all these disparate elements together? What's the missing piece of Wasp's character? Well, in a word, joy. The point at which these three things we've been talking about merge is the pure enthusiasm which animates Janet almost every time we see her on screen. You could change many aspects of this character and have her remain recognizably the Wasp, but take away that sense of joy and she's gone. It's the ultimate expression of the strength of her emotions, and it's one of the biggest reasons team morale exists at all, given the horrifying things that happen to this team on what seems like a weekly basis. And this joy, it's a result of her altruism and heroics. Let's get back to that ditzy thrill seeker phrase, but this time focus on the latter half. Because in Wasp, we see a character who embraces the essential thrill in superheroism. I'm willing to bet that everyone watching this video, when you were younger, you dreamt of being a superhero, of flying through the sky, shooting lasers from your hands, helping people. And this version of Wasp is so great because in a time when we've an abundance of crushingly dark and gloomy heroes, depressed by their responsibilities and failures, we have a character that reacts to her powers in the same way that any of us would. Excitement, glee, enthusiasm, joy. A joy which feels ripped straight from the pages of Kirby and Ditko et al. This is the Bronze Age tone I was talking about, distilled into its purest form. So yeah, she's a thrill seeker, unapologetically, but the same retro vibrancy which drives this is also at the heart of her philosophy and her role within the Avengers team dynamics, and I don't know about you, but I'd take this version of the Wasp over the alternatives any day. The great shame is that we almost saw a version like this, I think, in the MCU. It recently came out that some of Joss Whedon's early plans for the first Avengers film had Wasp play a central role, and they had Zooey Deschanel in mind for the part, and if you've ever seen New Girl, I think you'll agree that the energy she'd have brought to this role would have been just as vibrant and joyous as what we got with Earth's Mightiest Heroes. But you know, we got Black Widow instead, and she's a great character for sure, but you know the sort of role that the MCU put Widow in towards the end of her tenure? The emotional glue of the team? I'd be lying if I said I'm not desperately curious to see how those scenes played out in the alternate timeline where it's Wasp keeping the Avengers together. But yeah, that footnote aside, if Janet Van Dyne's Wasp is Marvel's forgotten heroine, shrinking away year by year into smaller and smaller roles, then I'm glad, at least, that we got this version of her in Earth's Mightiest Heroes, because I can't think of a better swan song. That about wraps things up here though. I hope you liked the video. I know I teased it a while ago, so fingers crossed it lived up to your expectations. Let me know if you think I missed any crucial elements, but if not, you know, there'll be more videos like this coming soon, so subscribe if you don't want to miss those. And apparently if you click the little bell icon, then you get notified whenever a new video pops out, so that's handy, I guess. Also, like this video or I don't know, I'll do something drastic. I'm not sure what yet, but it'll be big. And that's it. Here's me from the past when I recorded this to play us out.